so the, you know, when Joy brought that song in last week, I hope we'll sing it at closing as well. It reminded me of a story that I haven't told for about 20 years. So we'll see just how well this comes out. But it deals with this idea that you can do things by yourself. And the thing I love about that song is you can just imagine what happens when a drop of water meets up against the paddle of a paddle wheeler in the mill, and what happens. And then all of his friends show up. All of its friends show up. And the mill mills. Well, there's an extension to that that I think we need to add to it. And that's what this story addresses. And it might even be the story of the formation of the very first Unitarian gathering way back when, a long time ago, before anybody understood that there was anything that needed to be unified. That long ago. And of course, at that time, there was a wise and old and beautiful beyond belief queen who was bent on nothing less than the destruction of all of humanity. And of course, she had a daughter who was beautiful beyond compare. Not beautiful in that simple way that catches a man's eye and makes him feel excited for a little while, but beautiful in that way that your soul opens up and something inside you transcends and you know you just want to spend the rest of your life in service. That kind of beauty this young woman had. Now, of course, for this to be a story, there has to be a prince. And his father, in a very distant realm, loved his son so much that he kept him safe, gave him every opportunity that he could to be himself, kept the walls of the kingdom well defended so that his son and all of his people could grow up in kindness and love and peace and be willing to be there for each other. And then, of course, one day, the prince came to his father and said, "I understand that there is this beautiful princess in a distant land, and she has caught my attention, and I wish to go there and woo her and ask her to be my wife and come back here and live with us." And the only thing his father could say is, "Not a chance." What you don't know about that is that her mother is bent on the destruction of the human race. And that beautiful daughter, suitors have been going there for days and days, if not weeks and months, and maybe even years. And she sets tasks for them in order to have her daughter's hand. But they are impossible tasks. They're tasks that lead to certain death. And I forbid you to leave the walls of this kingdom. And his son fell instantly ill. Court magicians, court jesters, all the wise people took turns. After the prince was taken away to his bed, fallen faint, there was nothing anybody could do to bring him, rouse him back to life. And with each day, his life seemed to ebb further and further away. And this went on for 7 years. Seven of them. Never has the number seven vibrated with such intensity. No wonder it's a sacred number. When it was clear that the young man would soon be dead, his father relented and said, "It seems that there is no way to protect you from this. There seems that this is out of my control. it seems that you're about to make decisions on your own. You have my blessing. And you know how it is with young men? He was out of bed and feeling great. He got up, he went down to the storerooms and he packed up what he would need for a long trip. He got himself everything that he needed for the trip and he strode out the front gates of the palace, heading to meet his adventure, heading to meet his own life. Now he had not been walking very long when, wouldn't you know, he spotted a hill. But when he walked towards the hill was like breathing. As he got a little closer, he realized this was no hill at all. It was a giant stomach. It was the kind of stomach I used to have. It was a giant stomach. It would walk through the door 5 minutes before the head would rot. It was a giant stomach. So the young man walked around the giant stomach, and wouldn't you know, he found a head attached to a torso. And he said, "What is a stout man like yourself doing lying around here?" And the stout man said, "I was waiting for adventure. Where are you off to? I might like to come." And the prince said, "What would some giant clumsy oaf like you have to offer me on my adventure?" The stout one laughed. "You think this is big? When I really puff myself up, I am 300 times larger than I am now." And the young man, the prince, said, "Well then, you might be useful, you might be helpful, and I could use the company. I am off to woo the daughter of the old, mad, beautiful queen whose daughter has captured my heart and soul." And the stout one said, "This is the kind of adventure I've been waiting for." And off they wandered. Now they had not been walking too long before they found 2 feet sticking up. Not too big. Size 16. Yeah. Maybe 17, maybe 15. Just sticking up there. Attached to some long legs. And they looked down the legs, looked right between the feet and down the legs. And they could not see the torso because there was a forest in the way. So they walked down the legs into the forest. Eventually, they found a head that was attached to those feet via a body. And he said, "What are you doing lying here?" And the tall one said, "Well, I've just been lying around here waiting for some adventure." And the young man said, "Well, I'm starting to get used to the idea that I'm going to find some strange things along here." "Whoa, you haven't seen anything yet. When I get to my full height, I am 300 times taller than I am right now." The young prince said, "Wow, if you want to join us on an adventure, we're off to woo the beautiful daughter of that mad queen." The tall one said, "That's the kind of adventure I've been waiting for." So they walked off. Now they had not been gone very long at all on their walk when they came across somebody with an ear to the ground. And as they approached, "Shut up! I'm listening. May we ask what you're listening for?" "Everything. I can hear grass being munched 7 countries away. I can hear the new grass trying to grow." "Wow," says the young prince. "Can you hear what is happening in the court of the beautiful princess and her mother?" "Oh yes, I can hear that. I can hear the swish of a giant sword flying through the air, taking off the head of yet another young suitor who has failed." "Well, that's our direction," said the young prince. "You're welcome to join us if you're looking for adventure." And the one who could hear so well said, "That's exactly the kind of adventure I'm looking for." And was, they wandered off together. And it wasn't long before they came across this person who was standing on a hill, gazing, just gazing and gazing. The prince said, "What are you doing up there?" He said, "I'm polishing my vision. Right now, I am watching the snowflakes falling on the tallest peak in the world. One by one, the snowflakes that will turn into glaciers that will last for thousands of years." "Wow," said the young man. "Are you looking for adventure?" he said. "Because we're heading off to woo a beautiful princess." And the one who hears everything said, "I was expecting you." "And of course I'm coming home." Now they wandered on a little bit longer. Maybe there had been a few nights of sleep in there. I'm not sure. But they came across one who looked as though she had been through some kind of battle, some kind of war. Her clothing was ragged and torn. It looked as if she was bruised. And they walked carefully and gently up to her and noticed that her eyes were bandaged shut. And they said, "What thing has failed you? What thing has caused your eyes to be covered in this way?" And she said, "Unfortunately, it's my gift. For my glance is so piercing that when I look at something, it shatters." Any of you met a woman like this? I married one. "I dare not take off these bandages, or something is rent." The young prince said, "We are off on an adventure to woo the beautiful princess." One with the shattering glance said, "That's the kind of place I might be useful." And she agreed to come. Now on they went. On they went. And wouldn't you know, they came through the hot noonday sun. And there in the sands of the noonday sun stood one of must be a different temperament. No one could tell. They looked closely. Be this man, be this woman, what are they? What are they? And in the noonday sun, shivering, shivering, so cold, shivering. And the young prince walked up and said, "What afflicts you?" "It's no affliction. It's my gift. The hotter it is out here, the colder I will feel. And when the sun goes down and the night cold comes upon me, then I start to feel warm and I breathe the night air. When it snows, I'm at home. Oh, I'm so warm. And when there's a fire, oh my golly, it's cold." "If you would like to join us," said the prince, "we would love to have your company. For a different temperament is not unusual in our game." Now, as they wandered along, you can imagine having been by yourself with such an unusual gift. As they wandered along, they got to know each other and their gifts, and it was fun to practice. The one with the shattering glance got even better at aiming and shattering just what she wanted to shatter. The stout one could go to such sizes with the help of his friends. And the tall one, oh my, could he reach. And the listening of the one who could hear everything seemed to get even better. It was then they arrived at the gates of the palace of the Queen of Beauty. The one who was so powerful that she would one day rend all of humanity. There would be no more human race at all anymore. And the young prince, he just strode right up to her. Said, "I have come a great distance with my companions, for the lure of your daughter has caught my heart and soul. And I wish for her hand in marriage. And the old queen, she just smiled. And I tell you, when she smiled, she was even more beautiful. Well, she said, in order to have my daughter's hand in marriage, there are three tasks. Simple as they might be for someone of such beauty as my daughter, I still set them simply so that someone may have the opportunity to be happy with her. And the young prince said, yes, I understand. I've heard stories about the simplicity of the tasks. Good, said the queen. I have lost a ring. I need you to find it. I'm not sure where I was when I lost it, but it might be in the Red Sea. Fine, said the young man. He went back to his companions and said, whoa, this task is not easy. The adventure might be over soon. But he explained what was going on. And the one who had been hearing everything had already been explaining to them what was going on, so they were already thinking. And the one with the polished gaze said, it's not that big a deal, really. I can see where it is. It's hanging close to the bottom of the Red Sea on a little pointy rock, and it's sitting right there. Oh, it's too bad it's so deep, said the tall one. I can't see with all that water, but I could easily reach it. Easily reach it. And the stout one said, then we have no problem at all. And he waddled right up to the edge of the Red Sea, and he opened his mouth, and he began to suck such a great torrent of water that a whirlpool seemed to descend into his belly as he enlarged, and the entire bottom of the Red Sea became as dry as a desert. And the tall one reached out, plucked up the ring, gave it to the young man, and the young man was back in front of the queen in less than 20 minutes. Said the queen, no one has made it this far. I think an extra special celebration is in order. I think you should be feasted. I think you should gaze across the river there at that pasture there, and those 300 oxen will be your meal tonight, and you will feast like you have never feasted before, and there are 300 casks of the finest wine down in the cellar, and you can have that wine with your feast tonight, and all you have to do is finish that feast by morning time, and then we will know whether you are worthy. They're big. They were big. And he looked in the wine cellar, and those casks, they were big. I mean, it was going to be tasty, but wow. So he went back to the queen, thinking hard, saying, well, perhaps maybe I could invite my companions, for they have been with me on this long adventure, and if tonight is a failure, then at least they will have eaten well before I die. And the old queen laughed with malice, and she said, you can have one guest. Well, the one who hears everything started to smile as he nodded his head at the stout one. And as the young man came back in, he turned to the stout one and said, you are going to eat very well tonight. And the stout one said, yes, my mouth is already watering. I have heard all about it. And they wandered across the river to that pasture. And I don't know if you've heard stories about giants and ogres, but the stout one literally reached out with big hands and he'd pick up an entire 300-pound oxen and stuff it in his mouth. Like it was like some sort of snack before dinner. And as he ran around the field, stuffing himself with oxen, he got larger and larger and larger. And you can imagine what kind of an appetite it would take to eat like that. And you can imagine that after you ate like that, hoofs and fur and everything, you might have worked up quite a thirst as as well. And he was complaining besides, how is it there could be so little food served? Just as I was promised a brunch and all I got was a little bit less than a breakfast. His whining and complaining brought on the thirst. He was led to the cellar. He set his lips to the spigot of each one of those giant. He just sucked. He sucked so hard that not only did all of the wine come out, each one of the barrels went dry and collapsed. He sucked out every last drop of wine in every one of the barrels. And then stood up and said, who would invite you to a party with such a paltry amount of wine? Just as I was getting to enjoy the grape and understand where each one of the casks had come from, there's nothing left. By this time, the one who hears everything was laughing. He was explaining to the others what had happened, what was going on. And sure enough, the young man returned to the old queen well before breakfast time. And she was stunned. She thought, this one has unusual powers about him. I'm going to have to do something even more sinister. So she said, okay, get ready. For tonight, you can rest inside the palace. You can bring all your companions. And in the evening hours, I'm going to bring my beautiful daughter to you. And you will wrap your arms around her, and she will wrap her arms around you. And you will gaze into each other's eyes all night long. And in the morning, if she is still in your arms, she will be your bride. And the young man said, wonderful. This is a task that is accomplishable and pleasurable besides. Of course, the old queen, you know, she was true to her word. She brought her daughter up, and oh my lord, when the daughter looked at the young prince and the young prince looked at her, boy, you didn't have to talk them into gazing into each other's eyes. Their arms seemed to fit around each other as if those arms had been made for just that other body. You didn't have to convince them to hang on to each other. Oh my lord, pleasure was not the word. Far beyond anything you might feel in this world. Just to be certain, the tall stretched himself out to full size and wrapped his arms around them 300 or 400 times. Stout one sat down in front of the door so nobody could get in or out. And the others arranged themselves in various ways to help with the night. And everything was going along really well until about 10 o'clock, 10:30. When, wouldn't you know, that old queen, she had just enough magic and just enough power that everyone in the room fell asleep. Toad past the stout one. She unwrapped the arms of the tall one. She took her daughter, crawled out the window and down a ladder, and spirited her away. With 15 minutes to midnight, wouldn't you know, the spell lost its power. And the queen laughed because she wanted them to be in despair for those 15 minutes before she arrived. And all the lamenting of all of those companions. How could we have come so close? How can we have been? Oh no, what have we done? Our prince will soon be dead. And the listener was saying, would you please be quiet? I cannot hear a thing over your laments. I hear her. She wishes she was here. She is on a craggy mountain, only 300 or 400 miles away from here. And she is chained up. And the tall one said, not a problem. got the one with the bandaged eyes, put her on his back, strode over there, undid the bandages, whang, the craggy rock blasted apart, and so did the chains. The tall one caught the beautiful princess, two or three steps had her back into the palace, then went back and got the one with the bandaged eyes. When the old queen arrived at midnight, there was her daughter, smiling, still staring. It went a little cloudy. It went just a little cloudy. Oh, we got lots of time. The young prince slept like that night like he'd never slept before, and all the companions, and they were so thankful for how they had come together, and the adventure was proceeding just wonderfully. When they arrived at the banquet hall for breakfast in the morning, they found that there was no dining table. Instead, there were 300 cords of wood piled up in the banquet hall. And the young princess, beautiful as she was scowling. And she said, "I don't know what it is you think you saw in me last night, but how is it that you think that you would get to be my husband, have my hand in marriage, without passing some test that I myself might set for you?" There was something of the old woman in the young man. She said, "I will leave with you and be your wife, happily wedded. But first, you will sit in the center of those 300 or 400 cords of wood, and they'll be set on fire. And once you have survived that, then I will know that you are capable of being the kind of person that I need to share my life with." And the listener had been listening. And the listener had gone to the one that they were, that they, you know, that could, "Excuse me, but I think this is the time that you're gonna really, really get chilled out, because we need you badly." And when the prince arrived, he was looking around going, "I don't know if I can do this." And the one of a different temper said, "Go back and ask if someone can sit in your place." So the young prince went back and asked. Princess thought, "Oh, the heartache in this young man as he watches one of his companions burn to death." So she agreed. And the one of a different temper stepped into the center of the 300 or 400 cords of wood when it was set on fire. And it burned. It burned all day and all night and all day and all night and all day and all night till the next morning. Until there was nothing but ash. And there, on a stone seat in the center of the banquet hall, you can imagine the one of a different temperature, shaking, oh, so shaking. "Could you please get me a glass of cold water so that I might warm up? The frost almost killed me." The beautiful princess was amazed. She was astounded. But she was true to her word. So it was they left to be happily wed. The old queen, she couldn't stand it. She called together an army and sent them after them to bring him back, to bring her daughter back. But the listener was on duty and listening and knew they were coming and said they are about to come. And the stout one turned around and he was feeling a bit of a rumbly in his tumbly, you know, after that Red Sea and all of the wine and the oxen and the All of you. You can imagine what might be in there? And he just burped a little bit. Just a little burp, just a little, just enough of a burp that half the Red Sea came up. And there was no way any army could get past that. And it smelled of oxen besides. Anyway, they went back and told the queen they couldn't get around the Red Sea. She doubled the size of the army and sent them back to ride around and continue on. They were to stop at no cost at all. And once again, the listener was ready. And just as the warriors were within sight of the one with the shattering glance, he helped her turn her gaze. And now she was so practiced in her art that when she gazed, every weapon or thing that could be used as a weapon shattered. In fact, now there was a whole field of men and women standing there in nothing at all, gazing at each other as if they had seen each other for the very first time. Something very different than a battle erupted in that field. Well, it kind of looked like a battle. It was at that point the companion said, "You know, we are at the steps of your own palace. What an adventure. We hope to cross paths with each other again." And they wrapped arms around each other in the ways that companions wrap arms around each other. And they bid each other adieu. Now the young prince, he entered the gates of the village close to the palace. And he went straight to the swine herder, an old man that he used to go and sit with, and tell him stories. He'd sing songs. Sometimes he helped with the pigs. He introduced the swineherder as his father. He told the young woman, "Now we are here and we shall be wed, and this is my father, and we will look after the pigs together. And we'll need to get you some clothing appropriate for looking after pigs," for she was far too well dressed. I mean, even by Texas standards, she was far, far too well dressed. And a burlap sack was enough. She was true to her word. And every day she would go out and help the swine herder and her husband with the pigs. For months and months and months. Till finally somebody in the village stopped in and said, "Don't you know who your husband is?" I said, "Yeah, he's a swine herder. And he's really good at it. And he's off at the market right now. And we're happy. Always. Come with us." You know, the people who came and got her didn't even stop at the sentry gates of the palace. They were welcomed right in. They weren't even questioned as they walked up the front steps to the grand palace ballroom. They just walked right in. And in there were seated all of the courtiers. There were people from the village of all kinds of walks of life, from bakers to fishermen. And there, on the throne, was an older man, and beside him was a very, very handsome young man, but she did not recognize him at all until he came down and gazed in her eyes. Then she recognized him. Then she recognized him. Now you know how these stories end. There's usually a wedding, and everybody lives happily ever after. You can imagine what happens when the stout one comes to visit, let alone the tall one, or the one who hears everything. But it was a grand, grand life that they had together. One thing that I've noticed in my life from this story is that some of the strangest people I've met who make me smile the most, feel most content, and want to get up the next morning I love that story.
You're
welcome to ask questions. You're welcome to comment. One of the things in storytelling I've mentioned before, very often what happens is that there's one single moment that captures your attention more than any other. For me, this time, it's the very first time that it's mentioned that a sword goes slicing through the air. Boy, I see that sword.
I think you did such an extremely well at storytelling. That was wonderful.
Thank you. I think the part that's really interesting, if I bring it into my own life and things that have happened, and where I hope we're going as a congregation and a community. I think I might have mentioned once that I helped a few people get off the street to have a home. And a couple of years ago, we had that kind of a surprise foot and a half of snow. When I got up in the morning and I went, oh my Lord, what are you going to do with all the snow? I got outside, all the sidewalks, all the parking lots had been shoveled by one of the people who was just thankful that he had a home. He wanted everybody to be safe. He loved to be alone. Nobody knew who he was. Nobody knew he ever did it. He's a strange fellow. He gave so much. We had an opportunity once, Karen and I. Karen wasn't feeling so well and people wanted to help. And, well-meaning people are great, but sometimes if you need help washing the dishes, and somebody says that they'll wash the dishes, but they hate washing dishes, you know that feeling that's in the room? That feeling of, oh, God, I hate this. Oh, yuck, I hate this. And who would ever eat such a thing for dinner? And I'm washing it up. But they show up just to help. It turns out that there are people who like washing dishes. So we found that when somebody wanted to help, we would ask, what do you love to do? What do you love to do? And one woman said, I love breakfast. I love breakfast. And Karen said, well, I would love to sleep in. So if you would come over and make breakfast for my kids, that would give me the chance to sleep in, and that would be the most rest. That would be just amazing. The next morning, Karen woke up to the laughter of her children playing with somebody who had come over and made breakfast. Another person said, I love weed. I love it. Every day when I get off work, and it keeps me right. It keeps me straight. It keeps me in my path. That was Karen. Whatever you think. And so she left. They were gone about half an hour. Karen came back with a big smile on her face. I said, how did it go? She said, well, I held the pipe in my hand, and I knew it wasn't for me. But I was sitting next to somebody who was filled with love and joy. And it spilled into me. It was wonderful. I had another person who said, she offered to do the laundry. And Karen said, well, what do you love to do? And she said, well, right now I love my daughter. And I love my garden because we're picking the beets and the potatoes and the carrots, and we're making stew, and we're making vegetable stew, and vegetable soup, and we're baking bread, and I'm doing it with my daughter, and I love it. And Karen said, oh, wow, could I bowl of soup? That would be fabulous. So that night, this woman showed up with her daughter, and a big pot of soup that was put on the stove, and she ladled it out, and cut the bread, and you can just imagine the aromas. Amazing. And the boys noticed that her daughter was carrying a funny little case. And they asked what was in the case. And she said, well, it's a violin.
I'm a violinist, and I'm going to a place where I'm actually going to do exactly the violin. We're going to do some folk music. And the boy said, oh, we'd love to hear you play. So she started playing. Now, it just so happens that her mother is a dance instructor as well as a soup maker. So her mother started dancing. And then my boys went and grabbed my drums and started drumming alongside. And we used to live right at the bus stop, and the bus stopped. And people were looking in the front window, and they saw this woman dancing around, and they saw this young, beautiful woman playing on the fiddle, and the boys drumming. And everybody who got off the bus was just standing in the window in awe, looking at this, wondering what was going on. There's a lot of strange people out there. You know, Deborah's going to be here in a couple of weeks, and we're going to get the opportunity to ask her lots of questions. How to recognize everybody's gift. How to figure out who's the one with the shattering vision, who's the one with the polished sight, who's the stout one. What are the gifts that we have, and how are we going to bring them forward for each other and our community at large? We're going to talk to her about a chaplaincy program. You know, people should be thinking about that. Karen and I've had some training, but you know, it's open to everybody. There's going to be some really interesting things that we can step into as we start to recognize each other in even better ways than we know each other already. Damn, I'm looking forward to it.
I wonder how much time we have, Andrew. I'm wondering if we could take, I appreciate, it's a great story, right? And I loved it. I just wonder, I heard, you know, with the candle lighting and what happened in the United States with the election for president, and I'm also hearing lots of different things about what that means for people. I wonder if we could take, you know, 5 minutes and just go around the room and everyone share a little something about where they're feeling with that to get it out, if it's, you know, they're feeling despair, if that's what it is. But also, what's the opportunity in this? And maybe just from your place, not to engage, but just to share a little bit about where you are with that. Does that make sense to do?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that would be great.
And maybe we'll have a pot of something that we can consider as we leave around the potential of that. Take 5 minutes and do that?
Sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We'll start with you.
Yeah, I am hearing a lot of different things. I watched Saturday Night Live last night, and then there was some Black Americans that were hosting or there, and they're saying, like, well, maybe America, the white folks, they were at a party watching the election, and the Black guys were like, well, what you expect? You know, and it was like the white folks were saying, look, it's really a white thing, and it's about against women that this vote went, that the sexist piece of that. And the Black guys were saying, well, it's not new for us that that's here. We knew that. But this kind of election that says that we can elect someone who has some of that, it's just sort of, it tears the cover off what's here. And I think it's a good starting place. You know, there's some truth, some reality about how people feel about different things that is a good starting place rather than being hidden. And I think there's some lots of good that can come from that.
I agree with you, Michael. I was, of course, very saddened at first, and especially when I heard how all the little girls were so disappointed, and from that point of view, and because I am a positive person, I was determined to say, okay, but we can do this. But on the Saturday Night Live show, when those Black guys were looking at each other, and the white girl said, this is the worst it's ever been. And they looked at each other, and they think this is the worst it's ever been. You know? So It's not the worst it's ever been.
The worst what? What are you talking about?
Well, I can't get into it, but there is a disaffection in the States.
Yeah, I know, that's what you're talking about.
But this isn't about necessarily having a discussion. It's about sharing how you feel about that. And I get it's a perspective.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I think we also have a choice about the perspective that we take on this. And we can look at this as something awful to despair and endure, or we can look for what's our part in bringing light to something or to stand a particular way.
I personally am horrified by the racism and sexism that has been so openly expressed by so many. And at the same time, I am aware that he did not win the popular vote by, you know, several hundred thousand votes, million votes, I think, something like that. So he didn't win the popular vote, but it's still deeply discouraging to recognize that there are that many people who hold a belief system that I find quite frightening. And it was also interesting when I read last week a New York Times full-page opinion piece about feminism, and I think it was called The Men the Women Left Behind. And while I see that in sort of the breakdown of the voting, there were also many white women who voted for Trump as well. So you can't just draw the lines in that way. But last night at 3:30 in the morning, sometimes when we can't sleep, Dale finds, or I, some wonderful podcast on, and we listen to it in the middle of the night. And this was an ideas program that happened in October. There were two separate programs, and they were programs about looking at de Tocqueville's view of democracy in America. And they had a number of scholars talking about de Tocqueville and what he had to say about democracy in America. He, who in 1830 came to the United States and traveled all around and spoke to amazing people to get a picture of how democracy works and maybe where the weaknesses were and where the strengths were. And I found a certain level of, if not reassurance, certainly a sense of a process in motion. And we are in a moment in that process in motion. I do fear for the things that might change in the immediate. But I am riding the process.
Just one other perspective on what you offered around, you know, the popular vote, that was of the voters. I got to tell you that the majority of Americans did not vote. So there's a whole other majority that didn't vote at all.
49%.
Yeah, or half of America that didn't vote. That I'm curious about.
I have another perspective on it that my friend Carmen, he's an astrologer and lives in Toronto, and he said he could see that in the field the astrology said that Trump would win. He's like, he just had a strong feeling that needed to happen. And there's a very important perspective that I've been getting, and that is that there is a deep resentment of the corruption. And a vote for Trump was definitely an anti-corruption vote for many people. And this is really important.
It's very true.
It's very importantly, it's a really good point. Like the Clinton administration has a deep history of horrible corruption, connections with Kissinger, with all kinds of stuff. So people know that. And this is like, it's not all, and I had this perspective where I'm seeing people get all confused by liberal propaganda and all this, and it's like, there's so many things going on here. It's just so important to try and feel in your gut. And I didn't realize that after Trump got voted in, I would have this wave of excitement. Like, what is, there's something good coming out of this. I don't know what it is. But deep down inside, I feel something that's very good. That's my point.
I felt exactly the same thing. Energetically, I felt this, what has happened is absolutely necessary for the change that must arise.
And I suspect, you know, I we were talking the other day, I was thinking about the people that visited from Chicago, and the work that they've been trying to do, and they talked about how tirelessly people in their congregation were trying to get ready for this election. I suspect that they who have worked so hard have only just begun. And I think that this, you know, any ways that we can support them in that, you know, some of that will be, you know, recognizing even in our own community, you know, Nelson's not as tolerant as most of us like to think it is. But there's ways in which we can respond, and we can also be supportive of those who are trying to be in the streets in a way that somebody who believes it's now okay to treat a woman the way that Trump has been demonstrating you can treat a woman, there will be people who stand and witness that. There will be many people. And it's those folks that we want to support. And then at the same time, you know, if I come around to the strange folks on the side, there is this way in which people on the fringe do have some answers. And that includes the fringy people we don't like too. You know? Why is it that it's so much easier for me to get along with a heroin addict than it is to get along with somebody from Indiana with a grade 6 education? You know, there's some stuff in there that I gotta look at. And I think all of us have to look at, because they've been saying for a long time in a very quote-unquote uneducated way, we're sick of this. It's killing us. And nobody's paying attention. And, you know, I grieve a little bit for the way that I've been okay with that.
We're sick of what?
We're not having a discussion. Can we go on? We can have a discussion, but it's more about just sharing if you have something.
I have something. When I was born, the British Empire was the greatest empire in the world. And by the time I was 7 years old, there was the Second World War in place. We were being bombed and had to go live in shelters under the ground. And then we all know what happened. Britain was lost all its empire and became a relatively small country. And Russia and America became the great empires. And Russia eventually collapsed. And America was the great empire. And now, what we see, America is in many ways collapsing. Or something else will become the new empire, perhaps, or the new great. Maybe it'll be China. Maybe it'll be Brazil. It's just change. And then, like you said, that the young people say, this is the worst it's ever been. Right, it's changed, step back. And what we are changing into, we can only hope will be better. And we can work for that in our own way.
And I think we can do that without condoning anything that is inappropriate. And we have to keep our eye on that, but don't let it distract us from the goal of not othering for any reason.
I was pretty horrified when I heard that he had gotten elected. And my upstairs tenant had been saying all along, Trump's going to get elected, and I argued with him, but I couldn't believe it. But one of the things I will say is that recently I heard that he did talk to Obama, and he has changed his ideas a little bit about Obamacare. And that meant a lot to me, because I viewed Trump as a guy who wasn't going to listen to anybody or change, and he was coming out with all this negative stuff. Another feeling I have, of course, is that there was a statement about a woman getting to be president, and again, that's not going to happen. And I feel, you know, hurt about that, but I do have some less of horror about Trump, because I think you know, he has indicated a little bit that at least he's willing to have a reasonable conversation, and maybe he isn't going to do all the horrible things he's talked about doing.
Well, I want to mention that when Trump and his family showed up at headquarters, where all of his supporters were on the night of the election, and I watched it, the last thing he said was, "That man who campaigned for this position, that's not me. I'm not that man." That's what he said. "I'm not that man." And that was the last thing he said, which, you know, who knows what that is going to mean, but it might mean something.
Yeah, my sense was, for me, it just calls me even more to do what I believe. It's really putting my practice into practice. It's not coming from a place of fear. It's too easy to get into that fear and blame, and I'm British, and there was the Brexit vote, which was very similar. People that had not been listened to, who had been discriminated against by the system in all the forms, were just enough. And I think, again, like you, I see something hugely important. You've got to break the system down. You've got to crack it open before something new can emerge. And so many of the banks, education, government, so many things are calling to be broken open. And it's scary, and it's ultimately really exciting. It's calling us to be who we really are here to be.
Nice. I'm reading a book right now called The End of Protest, and it's the fellows that were at the beginning of the Occupy Wall Street, and he's saying that the idea of parades and lots of people, you know, getting out and protesting and making change, it doesn't work. Mm-hmm. It fails, and all it does is get contained and allowed to get off steam or whatever, but it doesn't actually change the system. And so rather than do that, they want to learn how to do that differently. Mm-hmm. So I think we have to be aware of what's going to be asked for next for you to join, and what that looks like. That isn't violent, that's going to be loving, and it's going to create some change, and it's going to be different. And then maybe it's going to be boycott of something, or maybe it should have been fully participating or not, or something, you know? But it'll be different. Mm-hmm. It is different already.
I think one of my mottos is, in engineering, you think of it as a fixed science. This is the way we do it. But I don't actually look at it that way. I come at a project, and oftentimes I try something, and take a, you know, I have to take a step back, I have to take it apart, and I have to move forward, I have to step back. And I think that's kind of what we're doing. So the demonstrations, maybe they, in a sense they don't work, but in fact they work, because we hear what needs to be fixed.
I like what you said too, the same similar thing, that it's got to fall apart, that our education system, how that's funded, our pharmaceuticals, everything, it's got to like collapse somehow. And maybe the political system, this is a that collapsing before you can rebuild it, you know, to be something else. And that's probably a scary time, because there's a vacuum in that about what happens in that. But that's what I'm saying, we need to stand by and be prepared to put the right bricks in place.
I remember hearing the Leonard Cohen, he just died too, right?
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, right.
One of his famous songs was where there's a crack, that's where the love gets in, right?
The light.
The light, the light. The light. Yeah. Love, light, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So that's kind of like the crack.
Yeah.
I wonder if we could finish up by saying, "We shall overcome."
I think step by step is really nice.
Yeah, let's do that.
Yes.
Okay. Let's stand up.